Человек 20 лет в разработке, 10 лет из них в разработке.
Person has been developing for 20 years and 10 years in the area of cybersecurity development. He created CoScoring. Please welcome Алексей Смирнов.
Добрый день, коллеги.
Good morning, colleagues.
Стартуем.
Сегодня Let's begin.
На такую тему, как проблема.
Today we are going to speak about the topic as the fathers and children problem, and thanks to Positive for offering me a lot of different designs, which were even in the topic of presentation. We are like a happy family.
Поговорим.
And we are going to speak about it today. I'm Алексей Смирнов, a lot of years in development. I'm the head of Profiscope, code scoring product. We have wonderful conference, .pycon and RosCon. Speaker, host. And you can see me in the community. I'm writing in the code mining. And I've been reading offline Python lectures when it was not a mainstream. Before beginning, I would like to speak about the prehistory. The history is that 2 years ago I've been speaking at PhDs with challenges to composite analysis of the software. And at the end there was a section, Q&A section, and Alyosha Fedulaev, we didn't know each other back then, he asked me a question about analysis, triage, transitive vulnerabilities, achievability of these methods, etc. And 2 years have passed. And a little response to that. Those of you who are interested, old presentation, you can listen to it. It's still important. There's a lot of vulnerabilities. OPSEC is only one, or ODIN. Well, of course, you can look at this story differently, because with all this multiplicity, you have to be able to cope with it, with statics, with dynamics, and with composite analysis. And you have to follow this all and find optimal solutions. And we're going to speak about it a little bit. How many problems there is in open source? Well, you will see it in the next slide. What's going to be the statistics? I'm updating it from slide to slide. What is the statistics about the third-party code? Plus minus 2 weeks. We have more than 250 million open projects with open source. And out of them, 8 million ready packages. I mean, packaged software, and 100 million of versions. So we are under the bottom. Out of these 100 million versions, well, about 90 million developers, and we are not above the number, but there's going to be 100 million developers in about 1 or 2 years. People who at least once participated in the development of the open source code, but regular participants are 8 million people.
Извините, еще
or six million, sorry, I'm too fast. Downloadability of packages have doubled, and it's growing thanks to all our wonderful DevOps practices. And of course, it's understandable, there's a lot of code, it's popular, there's a big number of popular libraries, and the number of various types of attacks is growing for the delivery chain of the software. From all the sides, from vulnerable packages, from the attempts of breaking something, substituting something, and it all comes to us, and every year we find something new. Well, vulnerable code is also available, malicious code, about 700 packages a month we are catching, malicious code, speaking about public code catches, but private catches as well, I can speak about them a little bit separately, and about protestware, no hype, it's not hype, we can check the old protestware, but it's not against Russia, but this year we have seen a lot of new directions, a new direction like direct stories against Palestine and other neighboring countries. Okay, let's speak about numbers, more specifically results of the research. How many third-party vulnerabilities we can find in projects? Let's imagine that it's a mono-language project. For example, they are written in one language. It doesn't happen like that, but we can see some cases. We have conducted analysis, and on average, we see that JavaScript 500 dependencies have been discovered on Python, 40, and everything else somewhere in the middle. So this is the average volume of dependencies in the system. Well, everything can differ from situation to situation, depends on your development, etc., etc. What is the directives and transitives dependencies? Let's see on this slide. How many vulnerabilities are in these dependencies? For example, if we're speaking, well, there is no security, and when you come to the audit, when people do nothing, and they've been just thinking about something, and then you will see the picture that is shown in the second to the last column. When there is a security, some kind of OPSEC, or maybe some kind of a control is available, then on average, you will see the following distribution by vulnerabilities. They still are stored and kept, and they can be mitigated differently, reviewed differently, and all this available. Roughly speaking, that's what we've started from, this is what we're moving to. It doesn't happen differently, we're not speaking about some specific objects where zero tolerance is a truly embodied practice. However, nevertheless, just in case, I've told you the word transitive, and thanks to Lyosha Morozov, he disclosed this topic during the presentation, but especially slide about it, which shows you this peculiarity, that we have our assembly point, our own code, we have directive dependencies on the first level, and those which are used by your developers. Then we have transitive developments, which are distributed by levels, and they all are represented by some big graph, and in the case if you discover some vulnerable peculiarities in the transitive dependencies, they can come to your assembly as well. For example, this is an example of a graph which shows through which components these can come to your code. How many transitive vulnerabilities are in projects in general? Why am I speaking about it? For example, if you will look and if you will continue these statistics, for the most popular languages, like in JavaScript, we have 86% in total. For example, you have used something out there, and then it has pulled a lot of different stuff, and it's a big headache, because it pulls a lot of different things, and maybe you don't need some of those things, and with big probability you still use it, because they proclaim this ideology, as we can call it, about distribution, about fracturing, they all ring by dependencies with each other, and you have to live with all of it as a developer of the software. And who is the IT champion? C-Sharp, it has 50-50 distribution, somewhere more, somewhere less, but nevertheless. So, let's try to remember this number. Up to 86% of all the vulnerabilities are in transitive dependencies. An important aspect, why am I speaking about it? Because many people think that those transitive vulnerabilities, you don't even have to look at them, but they can be on the surface of the attack and they can be exploited. That's why in my presentation I'm going to speak about it. So let's begin by speaking about statistics on transitive dependencies in open source. How can we assemble these statistics? Well, the question is, how? We can collect something from GitHub, we can analyze something else, and how Alexei analyzes all of this, and how you tell us, how you tell people about some specific numbers, where you get them from. In order to understand those transitives, you have to build a mega graph of all the open source. We decided to do it in a big way, and decided to take and permit all the dependencies which are downloaded regularly. We as representatives of competent analysis and supply chain analysis, we do understand that we have to know better all this multiplicity of whatever is being pulled to people under their hood. So we took those libraries and started permitting them, allowing them in order to understand who is being pulled between themselves, in which environment, and also language specific, because some have have scope, some have something else, especially if we're speaking about Java. All this has to accurately be permitted, distributed, and many library dependencies, stars are being put in there, and this also has to be taken into consideration. Okay, we permit all those dependencies, and what can we get out of this mega graph? We can get information about what percentage of ecosystems are tackled by specific vulnerability. Cool. For example, there's a vulnerability right here, it's on your radar, and you say, okay, but how it will affect our system? Then we'll disclose how deeply this vulnerability is in the graph of transitive dependencies. In other words, this can be a very popular library which you can find on the first level of input, and there can be a library which will be on the fifth level of input. It's an interesting story, by the way. And how fast community will react to it by analyzing the graph, which is enriched with information about the data, you can understand. How fast can you understand how fast the community will produce new versions, how it fixes the problems? And another question for the pen testers, for researchers. What topics of analysis can be selected on the first line? Which of them you can understand the most interesting joins, the most interesting nodes, and which of them you will start working, doing phasing and things like that? So we do this in order to know more, in order to make a bigger, better product and add these assessments into the product. Which big vulnerabilities do you remember? Some people say, maybe there will be some shouts from the audience, yes or not. But Lёша today was speaking about Log4Net. It was an interesting story. Of course, yes, it's Log4Shell. I've been thinking about which vulnerability we should look at. Sorry, but it's the best example. It's the best vulnerability from Google Trends. You can see this graph out here. And three examples, three findings have been reflected here. One story, it was a story related with libvp. It's in the middle. And on the right side, we also have HZ, exact utils, and little Zima utility where it was discovered. But Log4Shell, nobody was able to get better than all of it. All these protests were it's meaningless to look at them, by the way. As for Log4Shell, by calculations, at the moment of when it was published, we can look retrospectively, which is pretty cool. This vulnerability have tackled 8% of ecosystems, journaling ecosystem, everybody needs it. And what do you think, what is the most popular library in Maven ecosystem in principle? Options? We don't have Java people? It's a story about testing, and this library never is in the runtime. This is a story which usually is in the test scope, and nobody pays attention to it at all. But sometimes, and you can look at this testing-related information. It's an interesting graph that we built, the transition of community to Log4j call, which is a safe one. We permit it separately, and we separate all the environment where dependencies are located. We can build such graph on how the situation was changing in the community with the age of the problem that was discovered. So what did we have in the first month of its existence? What did we have in the second month of the existence of this vulnerability? How the community was reacting? How other package developers been reacting to this? And during the first month, we see that immediately after RBC had been writing about the problem, and they've been writing about it everywhere, everybody went and patched the main library. And when the patch was produced from the third attempt, however, there are two columns, green and red. Green one, these are new libraries, not a new one, but the libraries that were created their own updates and transferred to the G core safe version. The red one are the libraries which continued to make their new options with vulnerable LGCore. There was a certain drop in the beginning, and in the middle of life, the first year, there was also some drop. But then we look, there's another second year and third life and third year of life, it's right now. So during the second year of life, people have forgot about it, and about 2,000 secure versions and updates have been produced, and 1,000, it's a beautiful number, 1,024 of them were produced, versions referring to Log4j Core, which is not really a good one. And during the third year, we have a question mark, because they are equal columns, so it's very interesting how this race is going to finish. Will we see more components which depend from vulnerable Log4j Core?
Посмотрим на динамику залегания.
Let's look at the dynamics of placement through the transitiveness. It's a very awful graph. I don't know how to make it better, but nevertheless.
Залегает по уровню вложенности.
So how it is by the level of input? Our Log4j Core, if you look at our mega graph, on the first level, Log4j Core is not always, it's not the most popular one. It has the peak on the second level of transitiveness, which means that with higher probability, your directive dependency for Log4j Core will be better than you will create it.
Это 13 – это уровень вложенности, то есть…
13 – is the level of input. Even on the 13th level of the input of the graph of dependencies, you can catch this story. And it's available out there.
Но, тем не менее,
there are two libraries, but nevertheless, which are doing something like that, and they still have not been fixed. So what is being shown in these columns? In these columns, you can see the months of life. So you take the column 1, and inside you see small columns. The first is month number 1, month number 2, etc., etc. And you see that during the first month there was a peak, and then everybody forgot about it. But interesting observation started on the month on the level 9-10, when you can see some interesting spikes, which also can be analyzed. What do you think? Simple question. Has community won this problem or not? No, community has not won this problem, and they are not trying to win it. Speaking about the compile and runtime, only 20,000 versions of packages have been tackled. Not much, but still, in Maving system, they had about 200 packages, a little bit less. Fixed 28 during this previous period of time, and non-fixed 72%.
Этих замечательных пакетов.
Of these wonderful packages. They were not fixed. Possibly their parents are dead. Or developers, or somebody else who cannot patch things like that. We will never be able to find it out because they don't go from home to home and they don't ask you where do you work, what do you do, etc., etc.
Хождение по домам и какие-то
Speaking about visiting homes and interesting assessments which could be done here. What about it? Let's look at the same ecosystems that we've been looking at in the beginning and the speed of patch production. The average patch production speed after discovery of the vulnerability. An interesting topic, however, it's understandable JavaScript. Well, then you can say that they did a good job, and they are speeding up from year to year. For example, in Python, they did have interesting spikes. For example, in year 22, patches were produced 2 times slower than right now, than in 21. So we can also look at a graph like that, but nevertheless, the trends are pretty good, and we want to see better trends, because we do remember that the speed of exploit production takes hours, and even less. So that's the story we have right now. What else I would like to show you here?
Есть интересное еще наблюдение, то есть это уже не для этого доклада, скажем так.
We have another interesting observation, not for this presentation, but we're speaking about the speed of patch production after the disclosure of the vulnerability. But it's interesting to look at how fast this vulnerability is being published after the patch is being applied. The situation is also happening, and from year to year, more and more often, the vulnerabilities are discovered on the level of 5 days. For example, they've created safe version, and they disclose the vulnerability. What are plans for the development of this analytics?
конечно, крайне
specific megagraph. Of course, it's extremely interesting to look at cross references, Hello or WebVP. The story of when in our library of processing of a VP format we have discovered a very bad vulnerability. It's called C plus. They look at the library and they say, okay, well, it's in common and it's almost unused, but in all the browsers it is available and around it. There's a big number of shells in all the ecosystems, so it's extremely important to understand all those cross references and cross matches. Interesting to extend the coverage of the ecosystems in the maximum in order to structure this open source chaos, because we all know there's a Maven central, but generally speaking there's more than 300 packet indexes on Maven. They don't exist, and Upl dependencies from them. This is also very interesting to analyze. At the same time, of course, this is all as an addition to what do we have in JS, Python, etc. Another interesting thing is that we need to add subgraphs. Hello, XZ, or label demand, the story about subgraphs of small development teams, people who are implemented into the open source and are trying to make some patch, and they can be cut. Specifically about HZ, I have the answer, God knows, and I'm not confident that we will be able to catch them. But these algorithms are being developed. This is extremely interesting. I've been cross-match star catalogs, and right now we're cross-matching open source. And in the stars, there's much more. Let's speak about triage and transitive vulnerabilities problem. I'll give you some analytical information about it.
Скажем так, это
we have
10-летней давности, у нас полтора.
It's not the comedies, but this is 10-year-old problem. About 2 years ago, we have created the beginning of the experience of matching open vulnerabilities by manual. We process open vulnerabilities, we find vulnerable methods, and we understand the idea of the vulnerability, because those of you has been working with CVEs or DUs, you know that from the description you will not always be able to find out the problem and what is to be done with this problem. That's story number one. Story number two, we are pulling all of these. We're doing this in collaboration with Phobos T from Bauman University, thanks to the colleagues. It's a very big group of analytics who gives a lot of analytics to us. We've been applying a lot of different ML for code approaches, but unfortunately they are working as a good assistant, but they don't give us the precision that we'd like to get. Sometimes they check the initial reasons, and as a result we came to manual coding and description of these vulnerabilities plus certain automation that helps us not to suffer a lot. So, what was the result of it? Beautiful, interesting number. 23 minutes. 23 minutes on average analytic needs to discover the problem and describe it. This is triage without mitigation and making some further decisions. This is strictly lab, year and a half of research by a team out of 10 people. So, we thought that if you look at some open source stories, open vulnerabilities, then up to 23 minutes you will be able to be confident that you will figure out the problem. I've been talking to professionals in the market, and they say, okay, you will destroy all our market. Basically speaking, in the real world, when everybody are overloaded with work, of course everybody wanted to have some lab research and quality analysis, but half of the vulnerabilities have been removed on the basis of the principle that low, medium, we don't take, we take only critical ones. And all this basically, and we spend much less time because we need to do it fast for our business, etc. But you cannot argue with the lab. Of course, it's understandable that we have a mitigation stage and we have some overheads over this number, but nevertheless, 23 minutes, that's the story. Trustworthy interval, 21, 25, something like that. Very interesting statistics, and if it's interesting for you, well, with great pleasure, I'm going to talk to you about it. Is there any time reduction for the triage time from the experience? Well, it's an interesting business-related question. Yes, it's there. And this graph shows you with the timeline of recent months. Nothing interesting there. It's just a beautiful picture where you can see that more most of us up to 25 minutes is being triaged, and there are some outputs. Outputs on a cross-section between languages. So here was analytics, he was analyzing Java, and then you say, okay, here's a C-sharp. And he's like, okay, okay, let's do that. So speaking about this one, this store, it's like that. All these outputs are related mostly to this. During the Q1, when we've been starting, long time ago, we had 42 minutes per vulnerability, or something like that, roughly speaking, if you will collect OPSEC or champions, etc., speaking about people, and you tell them, okay, do the triaging, then you will get 42-minute vulnerability, and this is an average time, average time. In Q2, you will get 33 minutes, so maybe 10 minutes faster, and then you will go to shell 23, which you cannot hit over. Then, of course, you will be able to see that most of those points up to 25 minutes, but you do remember that people still are people, and it's very difficult for them to be robots. They need to switch, they need to drink coffee, they need to think, switch the context, and all these, of course, gives certain additional corrections. So what are labor efforts that we apply here? I would like to play with some numbers here. What we have 30 vulnerabilities per project. Projects of the minimum level of security, and maybe not high quality security, but not the basic security. If we have 100 repositories and 1,000 repositories, and then linearly we have multiplied it, directive dependencies will be this number, transitive will be this number, and how much time will be for triage in days and hours, how much time will be triage for transitive, and how much we are going to have in total. And then we see here that in order to triage and look at directive dependencies which are used by your developers, it's very easy to be done, and it's going to be the story about, well, you will look at the directive, everything is clean, everything works, everything's wonderful, cool. But in the transitive, you also can have a lot of different things here. And if in a summary you will try to look at zero tolerance or things like that, then we are saying that in total, speaking about 100 repositories, it's going to be 10 months of work of a specialist, and if we're speaking about 1,000 repositories, it's going to be 8 years. So one person who is doing triaging as a robot, he's not even doing mitigation of all these problems. He's just simply sits and analyzes. He's an analytic. Therefore, it's understandable that there's a lot of different other factors which reduce the labor intensity of looking at these problems. For example, a factor of good inventory. When a good inventory shows you that this vulnerability that you've discovered is also used and also is available in 10 other projects, then you will be able to much faster and simpler to find those problems and give objectives to fix them to other people. Then you will see a reduction. This reduction will be present. We have also this analytical information, but it's going to be in the next presentation. But nevertheless, this is statistics, just purely lab statistics. If you want to look only at critical ones, well, it's your problem, but nevertheless, we do know that much more can be exploited.
Продолжим переключаться. Поэтому
let's move on.
Опытные обсеки.
So what professional обсекs tell us, first of all, they tell us that the first rule of обсек club, never tell anybody about transitive vulnerabilities. Of course, I'm joking. And I think that everybody recognizes this picture, because some people say that my memes are too old. They don't want to speak about the analysis of transitive dependencies. Nevertheless, experts last year have been speaking about it during the PhDs. Victor, Dima Evdokimov, they've been speaking the fairy tale about scanners where somewhere in the middle they are saying, yes, transitive vulnerabilities are available, but we don't have time for them. And why are they saying that?
Они так говорят, потому что...
They are saying that because...
Переключу слайд. Все, Морозов закрыл.
I will switch this slide. Okay, Морозов, click. Oh my God, sorry.
Какие причины, почему говорят, что...
So what are the reasons? Why are they saying that don't want to triage. There's a lot of problems like that. Let's remember about 86%. And this is a shelf. If you have C sharp, maybe not 86, but 50%, but nevertheless. Number two, we have no time to triage everything because we are limited by directive ones. We're saying that we are collecting the OPSEC department. We have a certain vacancy and we don't have time to. It's difficult to patch it. People are afraid and people think that they will have to patch every link. And when they are looking at this for the first time, they are saying, oh my God, all this chain has to be patched. But fortunately, it's not like that. And today I'm going to tell you how and what. Many people think that, well, in principle, they should not be triaged. It's not us who are using them. We use directive dependencies. They easily hit the surface of the attack. Well, in one third of the cases, they are there. Yes, it's labor intensive. When directive vulnerability has been discovered, all the solutions are very simple here. So you're saying, okay, if there is an update, you have it updated yourself, or you mitigate by some overlay, you take WAV and mitigate it. Or maybe you're saying that right now we are going to correct it in our own code somehow. And I'm going to speak about it a little bit later. When vulnerability is transitive, everything becomes more complicated. The library in the middle, it's not yours. And you are not going to be able to do anything about it. And we have a lot of questions. How are we going to deal with it? How can we understand whether we use or don't use transitive vulnerable function to build this route, and how this all can be disassembled? Because when we look at it, we say, okay, right now we will take this E, and VDE will drop down to those links. But if you have jar in the middle, where are you going to drop into? Tell me, please. There is nowhere to drop. And manually, it's going to be done very problematically. But speaking about transitive one, if transitive has been fixed, let's look at this situation. Okay, let's see. We have an assembly. It's been blocked by certain reasons. And then we've discovered a vulnerable function. It's in green right now.
Well, it's
highlighted green. An update has been issued.
But
guys, they have fixed the problems pretty fast. However, the people who use it all and bring this vulnerable library to you, they have not patched it yet. So you have to wait. Well, it means that there is a chance to fix, but it's not yours. You can't influence upon this directive dependency. So the question is what to do? What are the options available?
Признать неактуальной, как бы, да? По разным причинам. Время нет, она реально неактуальна.
To admit it irrelevant, maybe due to the lack of time or its relevance.
В данном случае мы, как бы,
the second option is apply something. We usually use WAF for that.
Второй вариант – это обновиться, не думая. Потому что
another option is to go for an update without thinking. So we do it. However, how can we do an update with a transitive dependency? This approach only works for directive dependencies. But we can also patch the entire chain of vulnerabilities, although it may be scary. What are we going to do next? We can also do mitigation in the code. How? I'll get back to it. First, how to patch the chain of vulnerabilities? Let's get back to the old memes. For Maven, people say we will have to download everything. No. We just get the management section in Maven and set up the dependency we need that we consider safe.
Там есть особенность. То есть, если действительно это...
You think that is secure enough. However, just one caveat. If it were a security update, everything might be okay. However, getting back to our triage experience for open vulnerabilities, we know that correcting vulnerabilities can be accompanied by some new functionality in the commits, which brings us to another problem. You can bring in a security update, but your backward compatibility can be affected. So it's not always fast.
том числе то, что там...
Which means that it needs to be checked, and for this you require some tests for our attack surface at least.
То есть мы
Here we use the constraints mechanism and do all the same things, although they may look more attractive. However, we keep on praying because it can collapse in the future. Now, for the Python,
К сожалению, берем requirements txt.
Unfortunately, if we get txt requirements, bringing all the dependencies,
да, то есть по сути
we apply them to all, not just directive dependencies, and start praying again for nothing to collapse. Yes, it's associated with some specific features. You have applied your patch, and you'll have to live on with it. However, what are you going to apply to the next build? Which gives rise to some questions for the DevOps. Keep on praying.
Здесь примерно такая же история, не лучше.
Now to JavaScript.
То есть мы
It's the same here as for Python.
Руками правим манифест на безопасную версию.
We correct the manifest manually.
Как бы
swapping it for the safe version.
У нас появилось новое требование в
apply the drop modules. And keep on praying. We need the same requirements for
Но знаете ли,
well, it works for all the options. I mean backward compatibility. Do you know the secret? Some people say we need to patch. Yes, we need to patch. We need to make sure that our dependencies are relevant and up to date. However, it's not always necessary to patch. It is an option and a good one. That's true.
Безболезненный, то есть вам не надо.
And painless as well. You don't need to mirror third-party libraries, patch them, and then stay with some of them. Although many people think that this is so. There are packet managers that allow doing that. Wrap your calls for vulnerable methods. You know that there is a vulnerability and that it's being used. Transitive vulnerability. It's usually aimed at data.
Проверьте, что они туда не протекают.
Introduce validation for this feature. Make sure that there is no leakage.
Безопасности. Они начнут лучше.
It will improve your programmer's proficiency. They'll start understanding what can be passed over to the feature or method and what cannot.
У вас может быть
In some situations, we understand that there may be hundreds of such calls across the code. Are you going to apply wrapping to all of them?
Из вашего кода, который использует конкретную далекую уязвимую библиотеку.
And what to do next? If a remote library is used.
Можно даже взять всем греб, но это как бы вам не всегда поможет.
Somebody mentioned grabs today, but it's not always the solution. All the situations vary. They're different. We need to find calls for those vulnerable methods. How can they be found? We may have at level 5 or 13 some library. I'm sure I have to add something. You can always give up using a library. Just cut it off and forget about it. However, will your build work out without the library? Next question. How to find, how to identify vulnerable methods for such transitive functions? We build a trace. Many producers speak about it. So we build a trace for the vulnerability of vulnerable methods in our code. With this, we will understand which code features are used. By the way, we came up with a similar graph. We already have our markup, although we continue working on it. We've been doing it for a year and a half. So we filter our graph and show the chain of outputs. We identify all the inputs, and we also identify all the vulnerable methods. With this, you get
так. То есть вы можете играться с обновлением
зависимостей. You can play with dependencies, you can patch the chain of dependencies, and you can also filter your code.
Вафа.
Let alone things such as
пример, мы с Испраном как раз
overlays.
По технологии
WAFs, for example,
трассы, что касается примера,
we collaborate
назад, как бы такой пример,
traces a quarter ago.
Как бы,
we run both on there and our tools.
Относительно свежий.
Keycloak 24.0.0.
Конечно, тут уже
and it found more than 245.
Насколько я помню,
vulnerabilities.
Построение трассы и
it was Java, as far as I remember. Once the trace was built, we got 22 vulnerabilities.
Надо работать обсеку в первую очередь, как бы.
It's with them that the abstract needs to work.
Ответа, почему он.
And for the rest, the response text should be developed. Why?
Соответственно, таким образом экономится 90%.
The analysis is not carried out anymore. In this way, we can save up to 98% of the analyst time. This is how our triage is done, which expedites the analysis of identified dependencies is done with a trace. I mentioned 90%. It's extended stat.
Вроде как и немного, но когда у вас уязвимостей много, это превращается.
It may seem to be a little. However, when you have a lot of vulnerabilities, it will take you 8 years
to make it
10 months.
Истории.
We need to use technology.
Закинуть такое развитие темы. Я в прошлый раз на ПХДС говорил как бы о
something to add. I mentioned it last time.
И как это выглядит сейчас.
Speaking on this topic.
С одной стороны, у нас есть скатулинг.
On the one hand, we have SA tooling.
Скатулинге, в нем, он решает проблему проверки.
And this SA tooling,
как правило, это скатулинг, он
моногенеральный.
Ну, то есть
verifying a specific project. Usually, it's monolanguage.
А у вас проект, ну, он может быть на двух языках, на трех.
Working specifically for Java and so forth. However, you may be using two or three languages in your project.
С ними надо работать, как бы, это хорошее начало.
All these tools are cool tools. One needs to use them.
Обновление.
I repeat it every now and then. You can update your legacy dependencies.
Проблемы.
You can also identify problems, and you can get recommendations as to how to fix them. Well, most important, you should like it. All right, this is just one part. Another one is effective SA, which is about cutting costs.
Один проект или условно какие-то лабораторные испытания.
One is just one project or some lab testing.
Про большую организацию, у которой там больше тысячи.
It's one story. However, it's about a large organization with 1,000 repositories. How can you cut your costs on analyzing the same vulnerabilities and problems?
Показалось уязвимым, что вот она.
Only good work with the tools can help you.
Давайте посмотрим сразу там. То есть анализ один.
Oh, we have found a vulnerability. But we have 10-hour projects.
Массовые исправления и.
Let's check if it's present there.
По нашей практике.
With this, we can do cross-language analysis. Do mass fixing and so forth. It works with Python, with JavaScript, with Java.
На это дело надо крутить отдельный.
With just one and the same repository.
Проводились разово.
It might be cool if it was about just one-time checking. Well, it's important to understand where your vulnerability is among all those thousands of GS dependencies.
Гибкие политики, которые помогут вам отрезать так, как вам надо.
Flexible policies helping you to do the cut-off the way you need it.
Если
you should eat the elephant by the bites. If you have security policies, you can first identify super threats with exploits. You look at them, and then you expand.
проблем.
Но in some cases it can be expanded all the way to zero, while in some other cases you may stop at 80%.
Если есть уязвимость, то кричать и падать, то
if your policy is
у вас не будет.
Just cry and fall down if there is a vulnerability, it's a no-go. What's next? I see nothing better than the word ultra. And it's really cool. So, what's up there in the future? Well, I think it's about identifying threats prior to the publication of vulnerabilities.
It's a
fact. Once SCA has learned how to look there, it will be really great.
Библиотек, то есть не
factor analysis for the libraries.
Сейчас
I mentioned it 2 years ago, I keep on mentioning it now.
Поэтому как бы закладки
and today it's even more relevant.
Закладки никто не отменял, и это действительно
tabs have not been ruled out.
Вносят. Конечно, будут обходить.
And it's important to follow the authors of those tabs.
Штирлицы и все прочее, но
you can patch, of course, you can play
версии,
a security agent, but that's not everything.
Говорит, обновитесь, но так
we should do it at the code level. Usually, SCA tells you, do an update for this particular library. And it can be an update up to a specific version, or you have to patch the code. However, there are no such updates done by them, and we don't do them either. For instance, you have 100 calls for a vulnerable method, and you either patch each and every dependency, or here you are with 100 of wrappers. I'm speaking about specific problem solution. I don't mean code to be written by an AppSec and so forth. Let's leave it for a different conference. Although it may also be cool, and we have been following this area. Next, make WAF your friend. Almost no one is friends with WAF.
Передаю привет всем разработчикам СКА.
I'm giving my very best to all the WAFs following us and all the SCAs. Do it. Come up with it. It'll be cool. It'll save time. Expert time. And if we can save experts time, we can engage in statics markup even more.
Откуда это все и почему
I'm kidding. So, where does it come from? Why are we doing this product analysis? We are preparing an open source report. We will publish it, and it will be generally available. It will come soon. Please follow our channel. You will find more information regarding the journey of the packages, which packages are released, which programming languages are dying, and if we are going to live to see the end of it. My conclusion. It's as simple as that. It is great when all those parents and children are treated by experts, when all those children are identified and properly trained, and experts are geared with all the tools required for that. I would also like to say thank you to my team. It's not only myself, it's my team, my analysts. Thank you, Julia Volkova. Thank you, Timofey Kondratyev, and others, all those who participated in doing this research. And thank you very much for your time, for coming to listen to me. You can always contact me through using the contact details at our website. And feel free to use this QR code for this.
Вопросы же. Я что-то как-то так всех.
Are there any questions?
Я вижу. Вам сейчас принесут микрофон. Да.
Yes, I can see you. You will be furnished microphone.
Зовут меня Олег Жулин, компания Finity.
My name is Oleg Zhulin.
Большое спасибо.
I'm from Cynic IQ. Thank you very much for your presentation. My question is as follows. Getting back to the transitive search and calling methods or functions as well as SCA tooling,
есть какие-то инструменты?
How can this search be done? Are there any tools for that?
Разработки.
How can it be integrated with the development pipeline?
Насколько сейчас развитое направление именно вот в продакшн?
How well is this area developed? Or it's just lab analysis, as far as the open source is concerned. And what can be used? Well, there are commercial tools, of course. I'm putting them aside as to the open source. There is a project, unfortunately, I don't remember its name. However, it's an open project. Maybe someone could give me a hint. DeepScan, yes, that's correct. The name is DeepScan.
Вот, ну, точнее, если вам вот прям как бы интересно, но, опять же, у них там есть какая-то база.
More accurate. Well, they have some DB of vulnerable methods.
Но не идеально.
To be more accurate.
CodeQL.
Although not ideal, you can take the QL code and build something and try to implement it on your own and look for the methods. Well, maybe your testers or analysts will do it for you. You can come up with your own build, although I'm not sure how justified it may be in terms of labor intensity. Speaking about global best practices, everyone is dreaming about that. Well, I can talk about that.
Просто мастер скан.
Some attack.
Один из самых крупных, да? У них до сих пор только Java.
One of the best scanners. They can only work with Java. They don't work with any other language. Tickmarks support three languages.
Маркетинга нагнали.
Online.
И все.
Well, their marketing is cool.
У нас Java, Sharpы и.
We support three languages: Java,
Sharpы и три.
C sharps. And one more.
Из головы. Вот, собственно, Go. Go.
Oh.
Соответственно.
Miguel. Yes.
Здесь мы работаем по этой части, и дальше мы понимаем, как расширять. Другая.
We have been working on it, and we know how to go further.
Тоже вопрос точности построения этой трассы.
To build that,
кто-то вам скажет,
it's
можно
matter of trace accuracy.
Будет
you can hear something like, just scan the code, and here you are.
Ориентируется на то, что нужно перехватить.
Our approach
только тогда можно
is mostly about intercepting the build,
потому что в случае там
in order to understand what's being exploited, which is the case with Python and JavaScript. It's pretty difficult to do it using pure static.
Well,
the build should be captured, and the accuracy will be improved for low-level programming languages. With all those pointers and so forth, and static does not work well for it. So there is no silver bullet yet.
Типа супер безопасно. Кстати, статистика не входит в популярных языков программирования, но раз.
Statistics is not a popular is not part of popular programming languages. However, Rust, and it uses about 80 libraries per project, which is pretty much. However, the vulnerabilities of third-party libraries, well, they only show one vulnerability. So you can do it manually. Do you mean that the theory of big numbers works here? I think so. There are a lot of options with Rust. We have been following it.
Хорошо и безопасно, но
at this point, it's like this. It's cool and safe enough.
Спасибо.
Although I'm in no position to say that you should only use Rust. Alexey, thank you very much for your presentation.
Две проблемы, как я понял, две глыбы проблемы, да? Одна это
two problems.
Протриажить, а вторая это
one is to find, to do triage, and the second one to patch. Well, I can follow your
ассистентов, которые будут тряжить, то есть
example,
они будут кофе пить, контексты переключать.
How about assistants, those who are not going to drink coffee or switch contexts while being able to provide intelligence? I need to wrap my head around it. As real assistants,
чуть-чуть помочь они могут.
Но well, they can be helpful
нашу задачу, когда мы
to a certain extent.
Я проблему обозначил, что я инструмент втыкается в то, что в условных патчах, которые выпускают разработчики библиотек, содержат
real patches,
безопасности. Там зачастую
содержат.
Они начинают сходить с ума. Как бы там,
and all AIs go nuts, whatever you do.
Баланса, в том числе,
so it's a matter of balance.
Тратим на ручные разборы, но мы в нем
money-wise, the money we spend on
проводим
manual
когда AI, и за ним
checking. But after the AI, we also need to do verification. And if we're dealing with complex patches and we need cross-validation, it may take quite a lot of time. We have been looking at it, but not. It's not in full swing yet. Have I answered your question?
Да, спасибо. Мне очень интересно.
Yes.
Спасибо большое. Скажи, пожалуйста,
thank you for this very interesting
почему
presentation. You mentioned patches as wrappers for functions. Why just functions?
Параметры какие-то вредоносные. Почему мы не можем на уровне валидации?
Well, why can't we do this at the validation level? We can use WAFs, of course.
Попадают, хоть даже у зимы.
In order to then.
Я как раз и говорю про
continue.
Ну, то есть, как бы, вот.
I've been talking about trappers.
Я говорю об
Если мы говорим об оборачивающей функции, значит, это что у тебя каждая функция, каждая библиотека.
If we're talking about wrapping functions, it means that we need separate libraries and do this wrapping separately. Or do you mean?
Я призываю авторов чистого кода.
Data validation.
Конечно.
Well, I would like to invite the author of the pure code here. Yes. Approaches can vary.
Исходя из скиллов программирования.
Architecture. Wise and proceeding from the programming skills, probably some one feature may be developed to fix everything.
То есть речь о том, что просто делаем обертку.
Already.
Конечно, я не.
So you mean that wrappers are used at different levels?
Все равно.
Of course, you can use decorators and so forth.
И у нас уже истекло время, к сожалению.
I apologize. We have run out of time.
Выбери.
So I suggest that you continue.
Я опять забыл об этом.
Offline. Please.
Лучший вопрос.
Select the author of the best question.
Оттуда про AI.
I think that the best question was the question about AI.
Спасибо.
That came from there. The author of the best question, please.